I am Brother Stephen Elabo, welcoming you to Deeper Life Bible Church, Charlottesville, United States, a place where the undiluted Word of God is being preached. You are about to listen to our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, as he comes forth to share the mind of God with you and your family. I want you to be ready. Pick up your pen and your paper and jot down important messages as they will do you good. God bless you and remain blessed.
Pray. We're coming to Ephesians chapter 3, and we're looking at one part of the prayer of Paul the Apostle for the church, which is part of the prayer for you. I'm looking at Ephesians chapter 3, and reading from verse 14. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he will grant you. He's beginning the prayer now. He bows the knee. He bends the heart. He bends his will to pray for the saints, praying for the church. And what kind of prayer did he pray? What were the requests in the prayer? That he will grant you according to the riches of his glory. It's saying that the blessings he brings upon the believers will be according to the riches of his glory, not dependent on your circumstances here on earth, but depending on the riches of the glory of God. Then it says to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. We have a journey before us, and we have a goal before us. It's taking us out of earth to heaven. And it's a long journey. There are trials in the way, challenges in the way. There are things that will try to make you fear, make you intimidated, make you feel weak as if you cannot do it. But it says that God will strengthen the believer, strengthen the church by his spirit in the inner man, so that your inner man will be strong. I will be strong. Then it says that Christ may dwell in you. It's talking about Christ in his fullness. Christ the Savior. Christ the mighty. Christ the final sacrifice. Christ the anointed, appointed, approved of the Father. That he by his spirit may dwell in your hearts by faith. That she, look at this now, be rooted and grounded in love. He doesn't want the believers to be wishy-washy, to be shaking. And he doesn't want us to be bending to every wind that blows. He says we need to be rooted and grounded in love. In verse 18, that we be able to comprehend, to understand, and to experience, and to share with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. It's talking about something here. It says the love of God is broad and wide. It says the love of God even has layers. It says the love of God has its depths. And the love of God has its height. What does that mean? That the love of God has breadth and layers and depths and height. And then he goes on to say and to know the love of Christ. Not just to know it in the head, to know and to possess, to know and to experience, to know and to express this love of Christ, which passes knowledge. It's beyond limit, and that ye might be filled with what? Tell me out loud. All the fullness of God. You know, there are people that have an idea of the Christian life or see, you know, we're born again. And after we're born again, there is nothing else. That's what they tell us. Get saved, get saved, get saved. And that, after that, that's all. When you are saved, that's the beginning. And Paul the Apostle says, you want to be filled with the fullness, all the fullness of God. That brings in sanctification. That brings in Holy Ghost baptism. That brings in power, that brings in might, that brings in the totality, the entirety of the plan of salvation, full salvation, filled with all the fullness of God. And if you have been a stagnant Christian, you have been a person, you are not moving forward. I was saved. And the same prayer you pray every time, and the same challenges you are presenting to the Lord every time, the character remains the same, still, and there is no movement. You are going to move forward today in Jesus' name. Then it says, now, unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly, above all that we ask or seek, according to the power that worketh where? In us. The power is supposed to be working in every Christian. A Christian should not be running to somebody outside. According to the power that worketh in them. According to the power that worketh, there's an apostle there. There's a prophet there. There is a prayer warrior there. According to the power that worketh in them, let me run to them. It says, now, unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh somewhere in us, it will work in you. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages without end. And the people of God said, amen. I could come back to verse 18. That may be able to comprehend with all saints. That means whatever all the saints know, you should know. Paul was a saint as well as an apostle. All those apostles were saints as well as apostles. And all the believers that ever lived, there was something they knew of the love of God. And Paul, the apostle, says, don't lag behind. I want you to know. I want you to have, I want you to experience with all the saints. Then he says, number one, what is the breadth? Number two, what is the length? Number three, what is the depth? And number four, what is the height? And to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that he might be filled with all the fullness of God. I want to look at the word with you today on the unlimited dimensions of Christ's surpassing love. The love that passes knowledge. The love that passes understanding. The love that passes comprehension. Surpassing love. I want to look at the dimensions of that love. The length and the breadth and the depth and the height. I want to see that it is unlimited because it passes knowledge. It's unlimited. It's talking about God's love for the saints, God's love for the sinners that passes all earthly understanding. It reaches all people and it meets all needs. It extends to all nations and it covers all generations. It abides and continues until eternity. That's why it's so long. That's why it's so broad. That's why it's so deep. That's why it's so high. And this love that the apostle desires that we ought to know, we ought to experience, has its breadth, has its depth, has its length, has its height. This is God's love for you, God's love for me, God's love for us, God's love for the whole world. I pray you'll experience it in Jesus' name. The unlimited dimensions of Christ's surpassing love. Number one, the breath of Christ's saving love. You see, that love saves us. And it talks about the breath of the saving love, the love that saves. Number two is the length of Christ's sustaining love. It doesn't just save us, the love. It comes to our hearts, and then after you are saved, that love sustains you. And so you cannot say, yes, I got saved, but I cannot continue. I cannot be sustained. There is the length of Christ's sustaining love. Number three, the depth of Christ's sanctifying love. It sanctifies, and it is still that same love. It is the wide, the long, and the deep love of God that reaches out to the believer. It has its breath, as its length, as its depth, the depth of Christ's sanctifying love. Now number three is the, in number four, is the height of Christ's supernal love. Not just supernatural, supernal. Supernal means as high as heaven. It's coming from heaven to take you to heaven. The height of Christ's supernal love. You want to understand that everything God does, he does because of his unlimited love. His surpassing love. His love that passes understanding. Come back to number one, the breath of Christ's saving love. We're looking at Ephesians chapter 3. And I'm reading here from verse 18 that I may be able to comprehend with all saints. This is what gave the saints a kind of stability and steadfastness. There's no doubt in their minds. They had assurance of their salvation. It was not based on their feeling. It was not based on the winds that blew. It was not based on their persecution. It was not based on what they had in the physical, what they did not have in the physical. Because all the saints knew of that saving love of the Lord. May be able to comprehend what all says, what is the breath. And then it goes on. I was talking about the breath now of Christ's saving love. In Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 1. It says, and ye are quickened, who are dead in trespasses and sins. It's love that did that. We didn't merit that. We were dead in trespasses and sins. Our souls were dead in sin. Our spirits were unresponsive to God. We couldn't respond to God because we were dead. We had no feeling. We had no conviction. We just sinned naturally. And we sinned habitually. We didn't know they were wrong. Even when we knew in the head they were wrong, there was no conviction within. Our consciences were dead. And now it comes because of his love, the saving love of the Lord. And you, as he quickened, who are dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. We're being controlled by the prince of the power of the air, by Satan. I was thinking about that Satan from without, sin from within, society from all around. Everything controlled us. We didn't know what to do. But then the love of God came and said, you will be saved. And thank God I'm saved. I said, thank God I'm saved. Then it goes on to say, the spirit that now walketh in the children of disobedience. You see, when people are disobedient, when they disregard God, when they are rebellious, when they are sinful, they think it's them doing it. It's the spirit that walketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our lifestyle, our character, our conversation in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Look at this now, verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great, tell me the word there, for his great love, wherewith he loved us, saving love, the love that comes to save. Then he goes on, even when we were dead, he sees, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace are ye saved. It talks about the love that reaches out to you. The love that reaches out to me. The love that reaches out to the whole world and it saves the sinner. And when it says the breadth of that, when you say something is broad, you mean something is wide. This love extends to all. Have you thought about it? There were religious sinners. There were rebellious sinners. There were respectable sinners. Sinners of all shades and sinners of all types. You think of a religious sinner like Saul, the son of Tarsus. This love was so broad, it covered him. You think of a rebellious sinner like Manasseh in the Old Testament. This love also covered him and brought him eventually into the kingdom. You think of a respectable sinner like Cornelius a person respected by people, and yet he was a sinner. And this love was so broad and covered everybody. That's why we're talking about the breath of Christ saving love. Not only that, it reaches people at the beginning of life. It's so broad. Like Timothy, this love reached Timothy at the beginning of life. It reaches people at the end of life. The thief on the cross, he was about to die. Even though he was coming to the last day on earth, it was not too late yet. This love also saved him from the beginning of life to the end of life. That's how broad the love of God is. And everyone in between, this love is coming to you today. He will save your soul if you have not been saved. How do you get this love of God to flow into you and to get to you? By coming to the Lord, because he wants everyone to be saved. He doesn't want anyone to be lost. And I pray you will not be lost, because the love of Christ that paid for salvation is available for everyone. Romans chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 8. Romans chapter 5, verse 8, it tells us, but God commendeth his love. That's it. You could not have been saved without this love of God. Nothing in your hand, nothing in your life, and no endeavor, no trial, nothing you did could have saved you. But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. It reaches you. I said it reaches you. Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. What does that mean? There's wrath upon the unbeliever. Eternal wrath. They'll perish in hell if they do not repent. If you do not rescue them. If they do not know the way of salvation. It will be the wrath of God, the anger of God, the judgment of God, the punishment from God, and the indignation of God forever and ever. But the love of Christ comes to you, and that love has seen you where you are, and the love rescued you, and now you are saved. Paul the apostle never stopped giving thanks to God that he could ever be saved, because he knew how far he had gone. He knew what terrible things he had done. And yet this love of God was so broad that it reached him. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, reading here from verse 12. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Can you think about that? A man like that, or they were so injurious. In fact, it says, and I thank my God, the Lord Jesus Christ, who has put me into the ministry, who before, in verse 13, was a blasphemer, yet he got saved, a persecutor, yet he got saved, an injurious, yet he got saved, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly, in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and, tell me, love, which is in Christ Jesus. It's the love of Christ. And don't lose hope. Don't think you've gone too far. It is so broad, the breath of Christ's saving love. It will get to you. You'll be saved in Jesus' name. Look at Titus chapter 3. Titus chapter 3, I'm reading here from verse 3. It says in verse 3, for we ourselves also were sometimes